not everyone thinks the same and not everyone does the same thing. On my own research into anthropology and the way different people, different societies work, there's a thing called axiology. And axiology is basically, it's a study of value and what people find valuable. So we can see that groups of people, depending on where you go, find different things valuable. Now, I'm gonna paraphrase Dr. Joy Leary in this bit. The study of human value systems, right, and what people find valuable is the reason why people have different God concepts and the reason why people build different ways of being in their society. So for this discussion, I'm gonna separate them into what I call the ice people and the people of the sun. The people of the ice were, for thousands of years, raised in an environment that was cold and harsh, wasn't much food, and they came up with a different axiology. The ice people's axiology is what's known as member to object, and that object started out as food, meaning the highest value for the ice people lied within an object, and that object was food, and there wasn't much of it, and there were a lot of people. So if there's a deer that runs through, they're all thinking the same thing: get that deer. Now if you've got a lot of people around and you all got the same idea, the value system becomes every man for himself, every person for themselves. So you're gonna have to kill that deer, but you're also probably gonna have to kill a couple people too. So just to survive in that environment, you've actually got to become a savage just to survive. I guess the most barbaric savage within that environment would be the strongest, and the most barbaric tribe or clan would be the strongest. So if you go to the people of the sun now, they had an abundance of food. They had a different axiology. Their value lied within member to member, meaning the highest value now lies within the membership of a human knit family. So you have what they call tribe or what they call village. When you have these two different psychologies, are basically going to come up with different God concepts, because I'm a firm believer that God concepts come from the minds of people and not, you know, the actual deities that people claim they come. The gods of ice people are cold and harsh. And so when you have this whole member to object psychology, you also don't have very high value in human life. Because if you were to go to a ice person, and you were to go to a sun person, and you said to the sun person, "Where's your orphanage?" They'd probably look at you like you're crazy. So they'll be like, "What's an orphanage?" And they say, "You know, the place where you put all the children that you don't want." And they'll be like, "What do you mean? You throw children away?" And they'll be like, "Yeah, we do." They'll be like, "All right, then where's your old people's home?" And they'll be like, "Well, we don't have an old people's home. The elders in our society are the most respected." These two people have two totally different psychologies, and these psychologies have kind of morphed into the modern world. So the member to object is now stuff. It's not food anymore. The actual psychology is still ingrained, and the actual axiology is still ingrained within the ice people. So member to object, what are those objects now? The sun people have the objects. When you go to sun people's lands, whether you're South America, North America, Africa, wherever, they're the ones that have got the stuff. So when the ice people and the sun people came into contact with one another, the only outcome generally was going to be exploitation, because the ice people have a different axiology. The value that they hold is in the object. So you have these sun people like, "Hey, how you doing? Another member of the human family. You may look different from us, but hey, you're still a member of the human family." Then you have the ice people looking at their stuff saying, "How you doing? I want your stuff." And exploitation was bound to be the outcome when these two people met. Seemed like some people wanted to blow off steam with me, you know. There's twice now at Speaker's Corner that someone's come up to me with ill intentions. And all I'm saying is third time's a charm, because I'm not intimidated by anyone at Speaker's Corner. I don't fear any man. But it seems like some people want to turn Speaker's Corner into a war zone, right? So what's been going on now is that people have been digging into my history, They've been finding out what school I've gone to, posting it online, going on to my woman's Facebook. Khaled Mohammed said it best. If you throw a rock in a crowd of dogs, the only one that hollers is the one that got hit. So the fact that you guys are doing this, obviously, I'm hitting you where it hurts. So I'ma continue. I'm not gonna stop because you guys think I'm intimidated. I'm not intimidated by nobody. People walking around speakers calling like they own the place. Yeah? You guys are telling people what they can and cannot say. You people are not in Saudi Arabia. You're not in your own land. You're in a land where you have the freedom to speak. It's called Speaker's Corner. If you guys can't deal with the fact that someone's saying something that you don't like, you're not supposed to be there. Now the new running thing is, oh, Sarah's gay. And apparently, Gary's my husband and I'm his wife, yeah? So this is the kind of immature stuff that these people are going by, because they've dug up my history and they found out that nearly 15 years ago, I used to be an actor. I used to be an actor 15 years ago. But it's like, they feel like they've got something. They feel like because I was on TV and I played a character that was bisexual on TV, they feel like I'm actually bisexual. And I'm like, well, if that's what you guys think, then I must also be a policeman. I must also be a zombie. I must also be a space cadet, because I've played all those roles on TV before as well. So maybe I'm a bisexual zombie space cadet. I don't know. I don't know how these people are thinking. But I heard someone say today that you're supposed to allow yourself the time to grow and call yourself on your own stupidity. Now, nearly 15 years ago, if you want to go back there, nearly 15 years ago, I still believe Jesus was my Lord and Savior. Yeah, that changed. So, you know, bringing up stuff from nearly 15 years ago is not even relevant today. And it's like, these people actually think that they've got something and they ain't got nothing. I want you lot to think about something for a second. If you want to become a doctor, you've got to study for minimum 6-7 years to call yourself a doctor. You want to become an architect, you've got to study for a long time to become an architect. If you want to become a lawyer, you've got to study law to become a lawyer. And then you call yourself one. To become religious, to enter a religion, it's not a requirement to study anything. All you've got to do is believe the book. You want to be part of the religion? Cool. Say your Shahada and you're a Muslim. You want to be a Christian? All right, cool. Dip yourself in some water and then you're born again. You want to become a Hebrew? All right, cool. Come over here, we'll show you who you are. There's no study, there's no requirement to study. So you have people around talking to you and talking about stuff that they haven't even studied. They haven't studied the origin of the religion. They haven't studied the relationship of the geopolitics at the time and how that might play into how the religion came to be and sprung up. No one studies anything. So you've got people walking around, oh yeah, I'm Muslim, they converted yesterday. Oh yeah, I'm a Christian, I converted yesterday. I dipped my head in some water. And now it's like, oh, what do you know? You don't know anything. You're just a part of something. It's like having a contract and you haven't actually looked at it. Someone gave you the contract and you just signed it away. You didn't study what the contract said, you didn't study the small print, you didn't study anything. You just said, oh yeah, cool. It sounds great, I'm gonna sign my life away on it. So I'm saying, before you get into something, why do you not study it before calling yourself part of that religion? So we currently live in a system where we got to learn to survive. And learning to survive means knowing who your friends are, knowing who your enemies are, knowing what's good for you and knowing what's bad for you. For me, the stuff I've been speaking about has been shown to be bad and detrimental. If we are going to move forward, then we're going to have to come up with better techniques, because what we keep doing, we keep treating ice people like they are going to be sun people, and they're not. They never have been. And so it's not our duty to take our time and try and allow them or make them understand who we are. We are supposed to understand ourselves first and move accordingly within the system in which we operate. So for me, if we don't educate ourselves into understanding who we are first and understanding who your enemies are, who your friends are, then what you're going to do is that you're going to repeat results constantly, 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 expecting a different outcome. You're going to repeat something, expecting a different outcome. You're going to get the same outcome every single time. And it's because you didn't change. When you get into a certain environment, you've got to change. You can't be angry at your environment. Because if you currently live, if you live in the rainforest, if you don't understand that there are snakes, poisonous frogs, jaguars, all kinds of spiders that can kill you in that forest, to hate your environment doesn't make sense. Understanding your environment and what is out to get you makes sense, or can be out to get you, just based off nature. If you don't realize that certain people, certain groups of society are going to do what they're going to do when it comes to you, okay? It's not about hate. It's about understanding. Right. I had a conversation with someone at Speaker's Corner, and they were talking about space. And they were talking, I was talking about the oneness of space. And they had this thing of, there's a God that exists outside of space. So I said, simple question, where is the outside of space, and can you find an outside of space to show that we're in space? And they said, space is between two points, right? So I said, well, show me the two points that we're in to call it space, because for me, space is one. There's only one space. There's no more than one space as far as we know. He was saying there's outside of space, and I'm saying, just show me the outside. I'll pop my head outside. And we said, okay, that's outside, this is inside. And he couldn't get that. Until we kind of find an outside of space, then there isn't, because the same space that I'm speaking to you right now, the same space that you're looking at me in right now, is the same space that we all exist in. The only thing that separates me from you, wherever you are objects in the way. So if I'm here and you're there, the only thing, if you break the wall, if you're in a room, you break all the walls down, in your room right now, where are you? You're in the same space as the people that were walking on the street. You're in the same space. If you're on the street and there's someone in the building, if you break down that building, you're in the same space. The only thing separating spaces is distances and objects. It's all one space. The same space that I'm in now is the same space in Australia. The same space in Australia is the same space as where Saturn is. Saturn is a different planet, but it's in a different place. In the same space. There's only one vast space that we all exist in. Well, if there is an outside of space and Allah exists there, they say space is expanding. Find them where it must be expanding into Allah. Because he said Allah lives outside of space. If we're expanding, we're expanding into Allah. He said, no, we can't be expanding into Allah. There's another outside of space. And I'm saying, there's only one space. You know what? I want to talk to my African Muslims. Our continent has been colonized by Arabs. It's been colonized by Europeans. And it seems like African Muslims seem to have this thing that they like to use on the Christians, that you're following your slave master's religion, you're following the white man, you're following something that was given to you. African Muslims don't understand that they are also following a white man who had African slaves, Muhammad. And they're probably thinking right now, people are thinking, what are you talking about? Muhammad wasn't a white man. He never owned black slaves. So you know me already. I go to the text. So we're going to go to Sahih Bukhari. And people always ask about, why am I always using Sahih Bukhari? Because as you know, as a Muslim, or you may not know, Bukhari is the second most authentic book in Islam. So we're going to see if Muhammad was actually a white man. It said the Prophet never raised his hands for any invocation, except for that of Itiska. And he used to raise them so much that the whiteness of his armpits became visible. So we got this man has got white armpits. We go to volume 1, book 3, 63. While we were sitting with the prophet in a mosque, a man came riding on a camel, and he made his camel kneel down in the mosque, tied his foreleg, and then said, "Who amongst you is Muhammad?" At that time, the prophet was sitting amongst us. leaning on his arm. We replied, this white man reclining on his arm. So we got two instances now where people have said, he's white. He's got, just describe him as a white man. And they said he's got white armpits. Now there's a third one to see if he is actually white. So we go to volume 1, book 8, number 367, narrated by Abdulaziz. When Allah's apostle invaded Kaibar, we offered the Fijr prayer early in the morning when it was dark. The Prophet rode and Abu Talha rode too, and he was riding behind Abu Talha. The Prophet passed through the lane of Kaibar quickly, and my knee was touching the thigh of the Prophet. He uncovered his thigh and I saw the whiteness of his thigh. Now, we got three instances. Prophet Muhammad is a white man. But they use this thing, oh, you're following the white man's religion. And they're also following a white man. Now they're gonna say, now I said to you that this man had black slaves. So let's read. Volume 9, book 91, number 368. Narrated by Umar. I came and behold, Allah's apostle was staying on a mashrubah. And a black slave of Allah's apostle was at the top of the stairs, and I said to him, tell the Prophet that Umar bin Khattab is here, and he admitted me. That's one black slave. Umar himself said the Prophet Muhammad had a black slave. Let's go again. Volume 8, book 73, number 182, narrated by Anas bin Malik. Allah's apostle was on a journey, and he had a black slave called Anjasha, and he was riding the camel. Prophet Muhammad was a white man, a slave master of black slaves, and black Muslims are following this man. Now we came out of colonization and bondage from Europeans, because there are a lot of black Muslims, a lot of black people converting to Islam right now, and they don't know what they're converting to. They don't know who they're following. You guys are following a white man who owned black slaves, who had sex with a 9-year-old girl. Now, if you look at the history of slave masters throughout time, they were white men, they owned black slaves, and they regularly raped the women. Now, I'm asking you, you've got a choice to make. Is Muhammad different from the average white slave master that we as black people have already been used to? Because when you read his history, you are going to find all of these things. As a matter of fact, don't believe anything I say. Don't believe a word I say. Do the research for yourself, because what I don't want people doing is listening to me and being lazy and not doing the research for themselves. Do it for yourself. Look up all of it. Did Muhammad have black slaves? Go to Sahih Bukhari, get the app on your phone. That's exactly what I've got. African Muslims, brothers, sisters, you guys are following a white man who owned black slaves. Arms.